Welcome, everybody, to the newest edition of Queen's Court, where we are talking about Monday Night Raw from 1993 to today, and we're on February of 94, so we're on the road to WrestleMania. We just got done with the Rumble last week and the bullshit ending, and now it's, like I said, the road to WrestleMania, but first, I'm the Tribal Quuen Breigh. Alongside me, as always, we got Mighty Plessis and Husky Rhodes. How's everybody doing?
Fucking good. Freezing in the deep south today.
It's cold. Feel that. Doing good though. Yeah, football today and
Go Lions.
Yes.
I don't have a dog in the fight. The fucking Colts lost. Didn't even make it to the fucking playoffs. But shout out to Gardner Minshew though, dude. You're a bad motherfucker. Speaking of the Royal Rumble that you mentioned that we just did last week, I found out a fact like the day after we recorded that blew my fucking mind. Shout out to Wrestle Talk in the UK because they actually did this. They do a show they did a survival series on they did a Royal Rumble. There was like, name as many people that were in a Royal Rumble as you can with like three strikes or whatever. Razor Ramon was never in a Royal Rumble match.
Really?
He wrestled on the pay-per-views, but he was never in the actual Royal Rumble match. That fucked me up. Because I could have sworn I saw him in a Royal Rumble match before. But apparently not. I went and looked it up, and I was like, holy shit, he never was in a Royal Rumble.
God damn it.
That's crazy.
I know.
We're just talking him as the Razor Ramon character, right?
I think Scott Hall as a whole was never in a Royal Rumble. Hmm.
That's fucking wild. Even if the second run when they were the NWO, that is
when the NWO came back, yeah.
Yeah.
Because Kevin Nash was in it like 8 fucking times.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And they brought Kevin Nash back even after that when he came back as Diesel. That was trash.
Dude, when it went after him and Booker T left TNA and came back in 2011?
Yeah.
Fucking completely ditched the main event Mafia storyline and were like, fuck it, we're going back to Vince.
Like, I mean,
fuck Dixie Hogan Carter and Bischoff. Stretch. Yeah, Dixie Carter sucks ass. But yeah, so this first episode, we got Big Fat Smelly Fucker on commentary, Fashion Booger's on commentary, and this fucking dickhead is just eating the entire time.
Because he had like pizza, hot dogs. It looked like wings.
Apparently, it was part of his contract where he has to eat constantly throughout the entire fucking thing. He's eating nachos at first. He keeps trying to give Vince nachos and shit.
And he told Vince at one point he was trying to get Fox to sign him for like $25 million in like a food contract too, and like some other bullshit.
He's making fart jokes, gas jokes. This is like, wild.
And he burped too at one point.
Yeah.
Dude, he's talking about fucking, he's got gas for somebody. He's got fucking, this is all in the first 45 seconds of the fucking episode.
So gross.
Yeah.
God damn it.
It made me lose my appetite.
I could barely pay attention to this first episode because, like, I woke up and started watching it, and I was just like, God damn it, this month is going to suck ass.
Yeah, the first match we got, though, is Smoking Guns versus Horowitz and Riggins.
Yeah, this was the finish that the Smoking Guns have is really cool.
I love that finisher.
Like backbreaker into the splash thing. Like, that was fucking, that was sweet. Yeah. But no, Bastion Booger's commentary is just fucking me up, brother.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
He's got, like, mouthful of food and shit. Like, just talking.
And he mentioned a barbecue, because I put that he says he loves to barbecue. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, no shit.
No, I said no shit, Sherlock. You'll eat the whole damn grill.
That man got a rack of ribs waiting for him in the back. and he keeps choking on food and shit the entire goddamn time. He's just like,
I thought he was gonna die. I was waiting for him to croak.
He started choking at one point.
He choked like three times, dude. I thought he was like, shoot, gonna die. Like,
I was like, okay, this motherfucker's gonna croak. We're gonna have a.
And Vince doesn't give up. Vince didn't give a fuck either, dude. This fucking fat bastard choking next to him, and he's just like, whatever. Commentary. Oh god.
Dude, yes. I gotta keep this show afloat.
Yeah.
I need to know, Vince is the one creating these shows. He's the one that put himself through this. Why would he do this?
Because he thinks fat people are hilarious.
True.
I'm guessing. That's the only thing I know about that. But yeah, Smoking Guns win this one, and then we get this Brett versus Owen promo package deal with some splicey of some interviews in there. And Owen's just like, when I kicked you in your leg, it felt good.
Yes.
Years of a lifetime of frustration was let out when I kicked your leg out of your leg. He didn't say the kick your leg out of your leg part, but that's forever just going to be with him now for me. And then Brett says things.
I will say, I didn't really pay attention to what Brett said, but Brett's Stu Hart shirt was fire.
Yeah, that Stu Hart shirt went crazy. I fuck with that Stu Hart shirt. Brett, if for some reason you find us, for one, we're having fun here. This isn't a Goldberg situation. Don't take it fucking serious. But where did you find that Stu Hart shirt? Because we need one over here.
I would wear that Stu Hart shirt all the time.
I need two because I need to keep one intact, and one of them I'm giving the brother cut. So, I need a summertime T-shirt. And then we get The Rock at Owen Hart and John Paul.
And what a name.
John Paul.
Owen is so fucking great.
Heel Owen is so much better.
The ripping
better.
Of the glasses in front of the kid. So good.
Beautiful shithead heel work here. This is
Walking perfect. Kids is just so good in the early 90s. I'm kind of a dick.
Dude, Mocking Kids is a hilarious... As a heel is hilarious. Shout out to Chuck Taylor. There's an entire compilation on YouTube of him working IWA Mid-South where he just runs up to kids and screams at them to make them cry. It's the funniest shit. He just runs up. He scared two kids in one time, and he's just like, yes. Just runs up. It's so fucking funny.
He was champion at that time too.
Yeah, making $50 a shot, and he's IWA Mid-South world champion. Ian Rod's a piece of shit.
And during this one, Booger says, I want five large pizzas.
Yeah, I need five large pizzas. Look,
and
okay.
Then a minute later, he's like, where's that? How about that pizza? I don't smell it yet.
I don't smell it. First of all, I was a big fat fucker. I've never been able to eat multiple pizzas.
I couldn't even eat a whole pizza.
I can eat a whole pizza by myself easily.
I mean, throughout the day, but at once, no.
Yeah, I could probably, if depending on how hard the workout is, I could probably smash a large by myself now. But five?
Yeah.
Five, you fucker. And you don't even finish them because there's fucking slices of pizza just all over the commentary table at the end of the fucking show. But yeah, Owen Hart puts on a very, very solid Owen Hart match against this guy. And then fucking Booger starts choking on a pizza, and then it immediately cuts to Paul Bearer in this snowy graveyard.
Fucking so good.
So goddamn good every time.
Undertaker in the background just walking around.
Yeah, I love how he's like people. Tight. Yeah, he's like people are saying that they're seeing the Undertaker here and there, but I see the Undertaker every day, and Taker just slowly walks behind him. And he keeps talking, and he's like in the back corner, just looking back at Paul Bearer the entire time. It's like, oh, dude, it's so fucking good. This whole buildup to Taker coming back, it's like, when does he come back? Mike, is it like Survivor Series? Or not Survivor Series, SummerSlam?
Yeah, they do little promos, and then he comes back for SummerSlam, because in a few weeks, Ted's going to start teasing that he bought the Undertaker from Paul Bearer. Oh,
yeah, because this is like the beginning. Isn't this the beginning of Money Inc. too?
Yeah, we're going to get the start of Money Inc. here soon with the Tatanka heel turn. You know, Kama's going to be there.
Yes.
Bundy's going to be showing up here soon.
Yeah, and Bam Bam's a part of it too.
Bam Bam and Sid. And then we're going to get a one Brian Lee, the Bulldozer. I will talk more about Bulldozer Brian Lee with this. He shows up as fake Taker because I love Bulldozer Brian Lee.
Yeah, man. Like, as an OG ECW fan, like going back to finally getting to see Brian Lee again on TV, I'm like, yes, let's fucking get it. It's gonna be
so stuff. And Smoky Mountain was also really great.
Yeah, yeah, he did a lot of really cool shit down there. And then we get Marty Jannetty versus Erwin R. Scheister.
Yeah, God.
I have one question though. Why does he always come out with no music?
I think it's just part of the gimmick.
Yeah.
Because he's gonna talk all the way to the ring.
Oh yeah. He did all right.
Yeah.
He's serious and he wants to talk shit about, you know, poor middle class America.
Yeah, even though they're in the Poconos, which is like there's a bunch of rich fuckers up in the Poconos. The Poconos have more tax cheats per capita than the entire state of Pennsylvania. Okay. <Yawn. laughs> Okay. Okay, Mike. Okay. But this is a solid match, though.
Yeah.
Like, Marty and IRS fucking put their working boots on. This was a really, really good one. And then the fucking Quebecers come out.
Yeah.
Make their way to the ring. It goes to commentary and goes back from commercial and they're gone. And then it's like, oh yeah, they got kicked out. Watch this. Then they attack Marty, throw him back in the ring, and the other ref's like, nope, fuck you, get back to the back. So they go to the back. The Johnny Polo comes out.
And then Razor.
Then Razor comes in to even things up.
And the Quebecers show back
up.
Yeah, they come back out.
Fucking brawl.
they double team on Razor, get the distraction. Johnny Polo hits fucking Marty with the pool cue, knocks him out. Then Razor gets in the ring, starts fucking people up. Jacques eats the Razor's edge from that. And Booger keeps asking for more food. Shut up, you fat fuck. He just keeps asking, where's my... I need fucking... What did he say this next... this was hot dogs.
Yeah.
I ate all five pizzas, and now I need hot dogs. Fucking fully loaded hot dogs.
Yeah.
Like relish.
Yeah, I need ketchup, mustard, pickles. Like, you're just putting... you're not putting relish, you're just putting straight-up-ass whole pickles on fucking...
The Chicago dogs.
Oh yeah, Chicago dogs.
Yeah, he's from the Midwest. I'm not mistaken.
I think so.
From Michigan.
I was saying, yeah, I can kind of tell from the accent that he's got that he's Midwestern of some sort.
I feel like I looked this up before, and he's from like Northern Michigan.
Okay. So yeah, him being a Chicago dog fan, that's not shocking. Chicago dogs are the craziest form of hot dog ever.
Y'all put fucking sport peppers and like whole tomato slices and shit on your hot dogs. What the hell, man?
The buns are weird because they get all those seeds. Like, I don't understand Chicagoans.
Oh, yeah. He's from Scandia Township, wherever the fuck that is. It must be up north.
Yeah, that's that.
Yeah, that sounds like it's on the border.
Yeah, it's
way, that sounds like that's southern Canada.
Well, I mean, it's, well, technically it only says a 6-hour drive for me, but that's like way up in the UP.
I was going to say, yeah, that's way up there.
Yeah.
I love how Michiganers talk about the UP like it's just a whole other state.
It kind of is. I mean, you got to go across that wobbly bridge to get there.
Well, that's like New Yorkers thinking that Long Island for a long time was like, that's not New York.
Oh, yeah. No, New York, I have a bunch of friends in New York, and yeah.
Long Island is New Jersey. Fuck you. And then we get Gilbert and Sparky Plug. We get
Bob Holly and Dwayne Gill, two future members of the Job Squad, facing each other.
I forgot about the Job Squad.
I love talking about the Job Squad. It's the greatest faction ever.
I forgot about the Job Squad.
Greatest faction ever in the Attitude Era is the Job Squad.
Gilbert, Hardcore Holly, Al Snow. Who else
is the Gold Scorpio?
Oh, yeah, Duke Gold Scorpio.
Never winning a damn match. Except for Gilbert when he was only a heavyweight champion. This shit makes no goddamn sense.
Insane. Absolutely insane.
But yes. Shout out to the Job Squad. Greatest faction ever.
Shout out to the Job Squad. Booger chokes on a hot dog.
I really genuinely thought he was choking this time.
Yeah, I thought he was dead. I was like, okay.
God damn it.
Yeah. By the way, it still bothers me that the fact that outside of the Hardcore Championship, Holly never won a singles title.
I don't understand. Like, you couldn't have given that man an IC title run at some point, or like a European title, because he was there around that time.
Yeah.
That'd be hilarious. That'd be hilarious, though, giving him the European title with that thick-ass Alabama accent.
They could have done something storyline-wise.
It'd be great. I'm from Birmingham, England. Just do what Tracy Smothers did in ECW with the full-blooded Italians.
Facts. Or what was that Al Snow did, where he kept on saying he was dressing up and saying he was from all those different countries?
Yes. Yes. Yeah, they could have done that. You could have done that with Bob. Bob would have done fucking great with that. But no, this was a really, really solid debut match for old Thurman Plug.
Yes.
We get our first WrestleMania report with my boy, Todd Pattingill.
Fucking love Todd.
I'd have to say, though, I felt old when he said you can call Ticketmaster.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Right? I felt old when that old Ticketmaster logo popped up there.
Yeah, when that 90s Ticketmaster logo popped up?
What?
I mean, I feel old when we talk about, like, paper tickets.
Yeah, weird.
Having to go to a physical location to buy tickets.
Yeah.
Like, I remember going to, there was a record store by my old house that had, it was like, there were a Ticketmaster dealer, and that's where I would go to get all of my tickets for any fucking event that I was going to. But yeah, kids these days don't know shit about having to go to a physical location to buy tickets for a show.
The tickets getting mailed and like then you're going to the concert and be like, okay, make sure I have the tickets.
Yeah, you got to make sure you have a physical ticket instead of like scrolling through your phone to find the email with the confirmation.
Yeah, I remember going to like a Seattle Mariners store and picking up tickets.
Oh yeah, I would do that. I would do that for like the Pacers, like go to Pacer games and shit like that. Like having to drive to the fucking venue like weeks beforehand, and getting physical tickets in your hand. That was the back in my day segment.
Yeah, God.
I didn't want to do that.
We're going to have to, dude. We have
to. Don't look that old.
We're all in our 30s here. We have to do that. And then it shows, it says on the Mania report, the Randy versus Crush match is a Falls Count Anywhere match.
Yes.
But you have to win by getting them back into the ring within 60 seconds.
Yes, yeah. you pin your opponent. If you're outside the ring, you pin your opponent, and then you have 60 seconds to get back into the ring.
So make sure the falls Count Anywhere and a last man standing.
Yeah, yeah. They don't even say Falls Count Anywhere. It's just Falls Can Occur Anywhere. I'm like, okay, guys. You could have shortened that. Tighten that up a little bit, guys. Yeah. And then Crush versus, did anybody get a name for this fucker?
Todd Mata.
Thornbar?
Oh, it was Todd Mata?
Yeah, it's Todd Mata.
Oh. Okay.
I don't know where I got Thornbar from.
No, because he's wrestled before.
Okay, he looked familiar. Him a few times. He looked
so familiar. I was like, oh, yeah.
Yeah, he looked familiar.
When a jobber appears more than one time, I remember their name. I have a thing about jobbers.
Well, I mean, I remember Barry Horowitz.
Well, that's
because he's a jobber that works for the company.
He's the greatest. He's the greatest jobber of all time, next to Brooklyn Brawler.
And I remember Dwayne Gill because of that hair.
Yeah.
Oh, just wait until we get to Gilbert.
Oh God.
It's hilarious. It's just him with a shaved head impersonating Goldberg.
It is literally him mocking Goldberg.
It's beautiful. He tries to do the fucking pyro gimmick, and it's just two dudes with sparklers. And he gets fucked up in the pyro all the time.
Companies parodying each other during the Attitude Era is so fucking great.
Oh my God, dude. All the parodies during the Monday Night Wars are so fucking good.
Nacho Man?
Nacho Man and the Huckster? The Huckster and
Nacho Man?
Nacho Man, yeah. They rip on Savage when he goes to WCW.
Yeah. And then, of course, the BWO.
Oh, yes. The Blue Meanie. The Blue Guy, Big Stevie Cool, and Hollywood Nova. Yes, it's so fucking sick. I cannot
wait. Bischoff wanting to sue them, but he can't because it's a parody.
Yeah, they're not using your shit, so you can't sue. Right,
calm down.
Yeah. Yeah, so Crush kills the poor Todd Mata here.
Yeah.
Not a chance. Not a chance in hell.
Yeah.
And then it stated on commentary that due to all of the distraction in the Marty Jannetty match, the Quebecers are going to face Marty and Razor Ramon next week for the tag titles, and PCO is just punching holes in the walls.
Mm-hmm. Screaming angry in French. PCO.
And Johnny Polo is mad.
Johnny Polo is about to have a goddamn aneurysm. PCO's putting holes in the walls. Jock's trying to keep everybody together. But it's...
And then freaking Vince hands Booger a box of milk bones.
This motherfucker's eating dog treats.
Yeah.
And he's like, hey, they're not that bad. You fat fucker.
Vince's face during that is hilarious. He's like, oh, you're doing this. Okay.
I can't believe this fat bastard's actually eating them. Oh, God. And then, yeah, so there's no episode on February 14th because of
a dog show.
The yes! Mr. Dog Show. That was a regular
thing. That is my favorite thing about Monday Night Raw in the 90s, because every February you just miss a Raw because dog show.
Yeah, it was like a big deal for USA, I guess, to have the Westminster Dog Show.
Westminster and USA had like a long standing contract.
Yeah.
Like, it went like 20 years.
Yeah, so there's a, for the next like 20 something years in February, we're just not going to be able to watch a Raw because
you gotta
look at the pups.
And not the puppies that Jimmy the King Longer likes.
Ah! Like a creepy pervert. Then episode 2 kicks off hot because Macho Man is back. And Randy comes out and he's in full fucking form, dude. He storms to the ring like, hell fucking yeah, like freaking out. He's got that sick ass Raw jacket on.
The Raw glasses.
Looking like a million bucks.
Mm-hmm. Oh, goddamn good.
Ooh, and he says he's going to bring out the president of the Macho Man fan club. It's me!
I am the president of the Macho Man fan club.
I really thought he was going to bring, like, Jack Tunney out or something.
I thought he was about to bring a fan out here that was going to fuck or this just, whole thing up.
I thought he was going to bring somebody out.
I would have popped if he brought out Elizabeth. Okay. The president of the Macho Man fan club is my fucking wife. Look at this.
I'm pretty sure this is when they went through the first divorce, though.
Yeah, they were in the middle of a divorce right here.
Yeah. Which when he said that, I was like, I'm pretty sure this is because he thought she was cheating on him with a bunch of guys.
Yeah, he's fucking Terry. I know she's fucking Terry.
Yeah, because Charlie, after that, she starts dating.
Who didn't?
Yeah, right. So Terry literally and figuratively fucked everybody.
Oh, Terry.
And we get match number one here. We get the Quebecers versus Razor Ramon, and surprisingly, the 1-2-3 kid is no longer in the full leg cast. No. And he's just ready to go. What happened with Marty?
I was like, did Marty get into trouble?
Was he in some shit, or
I do not know. I didn't look that up. But, yeah. By the way, the Quebecers, once again, using the Mounties theme song. I hate this.
Yeah, I don't like it.
They literally just took the Mountie theme song and just had both Jacques and Pierre sing it. They just pluralized everything.
Yeah.
We're not Mounties. You say it in your theme song. You fucking asshole.
You're the Mounties. It is headaches.
Yeah, just giving me migraines here. But yeah, so that leg must have healed up quick because fucking kid was beaten ass. Dude, the spot that one of my favorite spots in the entire match is in the very beginning. Razor picks up Kid and does the fucking fall-away slam into Jacques.
Yes.
That was fucking sick. Like, that's a cool-ass tag team move. Just be like, get the big guy, pick the little guy up, and use the little guy as a weapon. That's awesome. That's why
always a great idea.
Yeah, see, that's why I still to this day want in AEW, I want Brody King and Darby Allin to be a tag team, and I just want so Brody King can throw Darby Allin at people.
I could see like Darby climbing onto Brody's shoulders and like doing some kind of like maneuver like from his shoulders.
I can just see it once a match. Brody just picks him up, just gorilla presses him, and just like, all right, you're going for a ride, little fucker, and just throw him at people. It'd be great. That'd be awesome. Bitch. And then it goes to the, I think Johnny Polo does some sort of distraction thing. Razor goes to the outside and he eats shit on this Razor's edge. He took it so sick because he did my favorite sell of all time in a Razor's Edge where he hits and he just completely rolls over.
Somersault.
Yeah, he completely
somersaults like he's fucking
back rolls over. He lands
oversells like a motherfucker.
He's dead. He is just dead. Just knocked out. It takes every ref the WWF has at the time to pick him up physically and walk him to the back. Fucking crazy. So come back. Razor and Kid are completely in control here, just working over the Quebecers. And then Diesel comes out. And he stops about halfway down the entrance and he's just watching. Just watching everything go down. One of the Quebecers gets hit with the Razor's Edge. One, two. Shawn Michaels materializes out of fucking nowhere and breaks the pin up.
Yeah, I don't even see him running in. Like he just in the ring.
He comes through the crowd.
Did he come through the crowd? I did not see that. I just saw him pop up in the ring.
He comes through the crowd because like out of nowhere he's hopping the barricade. I'm like, what the fuck? Where was he at? Like you didn't even see him like sneak through the crowd. You just hear the crowd start fucking going crazy, and you think like, oh shit, Razor's about to win this match. Nope. Shawn Michaels in full gear runs in, starts attacking Razor, gets out of the ring. And basically he's trying to get, like, they pull each other apart type deal. And then it says, it gets to a promo thing where Randy Savage and Yokozuna for the world title next week.
Jim Cornette is so good on the mic. He's a douche, but yeah. Goddamn.
Yeah, he's a disgusting human being, but God damn it, he's good at his job.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, says something like, yeah, you're an asshole, blah, blah, blah. Yoko's going to kill you. But up next, we have the designated hitter for the heavenly bodies, the Doctor of Desire, Dr. Tom Pritchard.
So this match should not have been as good as it was.
This match is so sick.
For this show to have only two matches, these matches went hard.
They're both awesome. Like, they're both really fucking good matches. Like, it's just it's a lot of build up to Mania, but like, yeah, the two matches we get are fucking crazy. Like, Brett and Tom Pritchard have put on a fucking clinic. Randomly, Nikolai Volkoff is just hanging out in the front row, just like, hey, how's it going? Just like randomly talking to fans and shit. I'm like, are they gonna point this out? And then Vince goes, oh, look, there's Nikolai Volkoff. It's like, oh, okay, you finally make notice of it. Because he's dead center of hard cam the entire fucking night. At first, I thought it was Bruno Sammartino.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, is that Bruno? And then he moved Nikolai, and I'm like, oh.
This is where Nikolai, they do a storyline where Nikolai is like trying to get a job because he's poor. And this is where he comes in with Ted. Because he's the assistant to the Million Dollar Corporation.
Right.
So Nikolai is like the first hire. Like, oh, I will pay you very little money for you to be. It's a rehash of the Virgil storyline.
Basically, yeah. And it's like, yeah, he's doing his poor gimmick. He's wearing a WWF fucking like agent suit.
Yeah.
Like, it's the fucking logo is on the jacket. It's like,
yeah.
I mean, well, they could play off of that. Like, oh, he came in and he was all disheveled, so we gave him a suit to make him look presentable on TV.
But yeah, no, Nikolai is going to be working for Ted here soon.
This match is fucking crazy. Like, Brett and Tom put on a fucking clinic. Cornette gets involved. Savage beats his ass and steals his fucking...
He knocked over Jim Cornette like a bowling pin.
He fucked him up, dude. Like, either Savage really shot on him or Cornette sold like a motherfucker because, dude, he laid his ass out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
like, that's crazy. Was like,
okay, that was unnecessary, Savage.
Cornette was taking some bumps, like, in his time. Like, he was taking some fucking lumps out there, dude.
I mean, I want to hit Cornette too, but that was...
I mean, I want to hit him with a racket.
I want to hit him with a gonzo bomb on concrete.
Yeah.
Actually, no, I'll let Brody King do it because Brody King said in an interview, they're like, is there one person in wrestling that you want to like physically put your hands on? He's like, Jim Cornette, next question.
Yeah.
call me fat. Fuck you. I'll fucking kill you.
But yet, Cornette was with Yoko. Yeah. And he called Brody fat.
Cornette now looks like he ate his self from 1994. Like, yeah. You're talking shit about how people look.
He's eating his words.
Yeah, literally. It's what you get for eating fucking nothing but Bob Evans and drinking Pepsi, you fat fuck. Anyway, I digress. So, Savage attacks Cornette, and then Owen Hart comes out. And Brett's on the ground. Owen comes out, and he's like, ah, Brett needs my help. He always needs my help. Get back in the ring. He also back in the ring, which And then he's like walking away like, yeah, he always needs me. And then like not even knowing it, Brett's got the fucking sharpshooter on Tom Pritchard and he's tapping out. He's like, yeah, it turns around. Oh, shit. Damn it. Not how this was supposed to work. And then fucking Brett wins. He sees Owen. He's just like, get in the ring, fucker. And refs pull him apart. They should have just let him go.
Yeah.
Should have let him go. That would have been sick.
Give us a little pre.
Yeah, give us a little. Preview. Little taste. Little teaser before Mania. And then we get another WrestleMania report with Todd. And then it says, Little Richard is going to be singing America the Beautiful. Burt Reynolds is going to be there. Fucking Donnie Wahlberg from New Kids on the Block is going to be
there. They call it NKOTB the whole time. Yeah. They never say New Kids on the Block.
Vince loves an acronym, I tell you.
Facts.
Jenny Garth from 90210, two old fuckers, and the dude from Hair Club for Men. Yeah, no idea who those two dudes are. And Cy Sperling, the dude that runs the Hair Club for Men, is going to be there, who's apparently...
So great! That's my favorite random thing ever.
He's apparently going to do a makeover on fucking Howard Finkel.
What?
Yeah, they mock Howard Finkel's bald hair.
They fuck with Howard Finkel, dude. They fucked with Howard Finkel so much in his career. He was the first ever employee of the World Wrestling Federation, and they just dog-walked this poor bastard the entire time he worked for him. And he took it on the chin, though, because Finkel's a fucking real one. And then it randomly cuts back to the ring. Yoko's coming out with fucking Fuji and Cornette, and Cornette's blowing a gasket because he doesn't have his tennis racket. You're a thief! You stole my racket! Fucking Savage gets up, like, all right, motherfucker! Like, I beat your ass already once tonight. I'll do it again in front of your fucking boys. He gets in the ring. Cornette tries to get in. He just smokes him with the fucking tennis racket. It's so sick. I love it.
That racket's hurt, too.
Yeah, dude. That shit sucks. I've been hit with a tennis racket before. It's not fun.
I have a few times myself.
It is not fun. Good. I've taken one on the shin before. That sucked. All right. Then we get episode 3. We get Downtown Bruno. Harvey Whippleman is on commentary.
I think episode. Out of the three, I think he was my favorite on commentary.
I love Harvey Whippleman on commentary.
So it sounds like normal back and forth commentary. Like, no bullshit. Yeah. Like, it sounded normal.
Yeah. Yeah.
They don't mention who it is. So I was confused for the first 10 minutes. Okay, who is this other person on commentary?
Yeah.
They don't say a name.
I think Vince did say it like one time.
Yeah, he says it really quick at the very beginning because they're starting out like with Randy and Yoko like right out the gate.
Okay, so I must have missed that because I was like, who the fuck is this?
Yeah, they didn't do any like of like the pre build up like they did with the first two because they're like we're starting out right out the gate with a match. Get Randy Savage and Yokozuna. This was awesome because we see Randy Savage in a ring. So
yeah, and he went on the attack right away. Great balls of fire.
Oh yeah, but that yellow he was wearing. Oh my, like I had to look away because it hurt my eyes. Like it was so bright.
It was very loud. It was very loud outfit.
That the leopard print Savage uniform is a very interesting take.
Leopard print Savage going crazy. Dude, this match was fucking awesome. Really solid back and forth. Fuji and fucking Cornette both get on the apron. They both eat shit.
Yeah. Cornette, of course, causing BS.
Cornette gets the goddamn ref in a headlock.
That was
look at the wild. Cam.
He's got his racket back.
There's ways to distract a ref, and that is just a weird way to do it.
Why? Dude, you put your hands on a referee. That's an automatic disqualification. And Cornette got this motherfucker in a headlock. Look at the camera like, look, you're on TV, blah, blah, blah. or whatever the fuck. Fuji dumps the salt out of the bucket, gives it to Yoko. And of course, Savage gets it, smokes Yoko with the fucking the bucket. They're both dead. Savage comes back, hits a fucking beautiful elbow drop, and then Crush materializes.
Yeah. Which is why, for Yoko.
Yeah. Which is why on my tag here, so many non-finishes. Mm-hmm. Because there was a lot of these weird BS DQ finishes in this month. My God.
I didn't realize that. Holy shit, you're right.
Yeah.
There's a lot of DQ finishes in this. And then Bret Hart comes out to try and even the odds. He's getting fucked up. And then Captain Boring, Lex Luger, comes out.
God, of course, I hate this man.
And of course he has to be fucking Superman and clear house.
They needed a Hogan.
Mm.
Wouldn't let Savage be Hogan. So they gotta put Lex Luger as Hogan. And then we get Mike Corey getting his lunch money stolen by the bully, Bam Bam Bigelow.
Finally, Bam Bam got facial hair again, so he doesn't look weird as shit.
I literally put Bam Bam's growing his beard back out, all is right in the world. Yeah, this was just a beatdown.
It was a beatdown, but on commentary, you have him Whippleman crushing on Una.
Yeah.
Which was so beautiful she is.
She's so hot, Vince. Look at her. Just fucking look at her, dude. She's hot.
No, like, no disrespect to Una Vachon and the Vachon family, because historic family, great wrestlers.
1,000%.
That is the weirdest combination ever.
Her and Harvey Whippleman?
Yeah, that is a weird, like, what? Her and Bam Bam is a weird combination. That is, what the fuck?
I mean, it makes more sense with Bam Bam than it does Downtown Bruno.
Fucking flirting with her, or hitting on her, yeah.
I mean, I'd rather have Harvey Whippleman hitting on Luna Vachon than Bastion Booger hitting on Luna Vachon.
True. Very true.
And not having to hear her go,
get off me.
can't deal with it. And then we get Earthquake versus the Black Phantom.
Do you know who this is?
Yeah. Banging and banging, brother. It's Gangrel.
No shit.
The Black Phantom is Gangrel.
I was trying to figure out who this guy was.
It's Gangrel.
I met him.
Fucking fanging and banging out here under the hood. I was like, hell yeah. It's the Vampire Warrior, brother.
This is right before he goes to ECW.
Yeah, this is like a couple of months before he goes to ECW as the Vampire Warrior.
Yeah.
Which is basically just Gangrel without the... Yeah, and Luna goes to ECW too.
Again, why I think Vince and Paul were working together from the beginning.
It's the pieces are starting to fall into play more as I watch these Raws. I'm like, oh, wait. That guy was in ECW. That guy was in ECW. That guy was in ECW. Mike's on to something.
Yeah.
Mike's on to something with this.
Because Luna gets sent to go to ECW as Tommy's, like, next side piece. Like, next girlfriend.
Yeah.
And then Vampire Warrior comes in like, you took my girlfriend. What are you doing with my girl? You took my wife.
You're fucking my wife. Look at my teeth. You're fucking with my wife.
Vampire Warrior is another one of Raven's henchmen.
Oh, yes. Because that was, that was like right at the kind of the beginning of the whole
Raven Tommy storyline. Yeah, because he leaves in a few months to go there. God damn you, Vincent Paul.
Sons of bitches. And it states, because originally in the WrestleMania report, it was said that Earthquake was going to face Ludwig Borga, but Ludwig Borga's gone.
The Tonya Harding story?
Yeah.
That was wild.
I know. You're throwing that in? Really? Really?
Because literally it happened. I checked the calendars. That situation happened like a week before.
Yeah, it was extremely topical.
Yeah. Tonya Hart attacking, what is
Nancy Kerrigan.
Yeah, Kerrigan with the pipe.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I was like, well, that's a little too soon. That girl is still in the hospital.
Yeah, I know. It's like, dude, she's still in recovery, man. That's fucked up. Like, you couldn't have let that story cool down a little bit before you start throwing shots? Come on, Vince.
Tonya Harding was facing jail time. Motherfuckers were arrested.
Yeah, there was a lot of people fucking arrested on that shit. But yeah, so we get Adam Bomb and Earthquake at Mania 10 instead. Yeah. Which, in all accounts, right decision.
Facts. Because fuck Borga.
Because fuck a little bit Borga. And then next match, we get John Crystal versus Quang. And Cy Sperling calls in. And this is where he says he's going to do the makeover on Howard Finkel. And he's going to take him out on the town and show him some show him around some beautiful women. And they're going to staple a fucking wig on his head or some shit. What the fuck is happening?
I love this because Harvey Whippleman leaves so he can manage Quang. So Vince just shoots on him and just starts making fun of him.
He starts talking shit as soon as he fucking puts the headset down. He doesn't even give him a chance. I got more important business to talk to, McMahon. He says he's the vice mayor of some small town in Mississippi or some shit. It's like, what the fuck? But yeah, Quang ends it pretty quick with a super kick. Still weird seeing Savio Vega do this weird ninja gimmick.
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense to me.
And then we get my least favorite part of
this. This was hilarious to me.
Why was Sean butt naked with Diesel in the room?
Yeah.
I know there's some sus shit to this, but it's fucking hilarious. There's not sus.
This whole thing was sus.
I agree with you. I agree with you.
Now, why are they calling Stan Lane Mr. South Beach?
Yeah, the South Beach stud, sweet Stan Lane. I guess he was down in South Florida just being a hound. I don't know.
Everything about this interview creeped me out.
This is the funniest part, dude. It's just fucking Stan Lane's knocking on the door, and he's like, hey, Sean, I want an interview. And it shows Sean in a towel.
Yeah.
And he's like, hold on.
Not even fully. Yeah. Like, he's like, let me get, like, what are we doing here, Sean and Diesel? Like, what is happening?
I know. I have a lot of questions. But he's like, hold on, I'll do an interview with you, Stan. Let me put on something real quick. All right, you can come in. Comes back in. He still just has the fucking towel. He has the fucking towel on, but he just puts the belt on over the top. I was fucking dying, dude. He's like, all right, I'm ready. Let's do this interview. And then it keeps cutting to like black and white footage of him attacking Razor. And then it cuts back and he's in a different fucking position. He's like laying on the couch. Diesel just staring at him just like, why are you such a weird fucker?
Everything about this creeps me out.
Well, at the one point, Diesel has the look on his face like, Sean, can you at least put some fucking pants on for Christ's sake? You're freaking me out here. Why are you just walking around in a towel? This is fucked up. This is the set of the weirdest porn. This is the weirdest porn. It's just Diesel just sitting in the corner.
Before Sean was supposed to be on Playgirl 2.
Yeah, this was him building up to being the centerfolded Playgirl. Oh god, yeah. And then
Breeze face.
Ew.
Yeah. It's a thing. It was a thing. Just
like
it
happened. Posed
1,000%.
Hanging out on a magazine.
Yeah, he was a legit Playgirl.
Oh,
he's the cover.
Ew. This was like what 96,
96, 97. He was champion. He was WWF champion at that time.
Yeah, this was. Yeah, it was after he won the belt from Brett.
Yeah, no, it was like him and Playgirl, Sable and Playboy. It was a whole thing. The 90s was weird.
Vince wanted to get his superstars naked.
And Yeah.
It is what it is.
Literally.
Literally. He had there were so many fucking of the women in WWE like doing Playboy. There was a ton of them.
Yeah,
like a Sable, the China did it.
Was the thing, and they—it's not the fact that they're like they were on Playboy. It's like they advertised it. Like, okay, we're gonna just like do segments where we're just gonna promote Playboy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because Vince was lining Hugh Hefner's pockets for a little bit. Yeah. He's like, "Hey, let me give you some money. We're gonna promote the shit out of your fucking magazine, and we're gonna have." Some of our women pose for you.
Yeah.
And that old pervert was like, well, all right, fucking let's go. Let's get it. Give me that money. And then we get a promo next week for Owen Hart and Crush versus the Smoking Guns. So that'll be the start of next week's show. Very interesting.
It is a weird tag team combination.
It is a weird tag team combination, but... Both of them end up in the Nation of Domination.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, because Crush has that, like, I just got out of jail gimmick, which was so crazy with, like, braids.
Yeah, he's got micro braids, a nose ring, and he's just like, yeah, I'm an ex-con now. Yeah.
I'm like Dominic with the tattoo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, he's got, like, a tear tattoo on his face. He's got,
like, a road rash, like, on his clothes.
Oh,
yeah,
like yeah, hit by a car. It was crushing the Attitude Era was a strange thing.
Yeah, he had some wild gimmick changes.
Yeah, because that and then you get the racist biker gang.
Oh yeah, yeah, because two of those dudes are like legit Nazis.
yeah,
it's fucked. It's fucked.
Disciple of Apocalypse. Yeah.
Yeah. DOA. It's Sons of Anarchy with extra racism.
But we also get what's his name that just came back with AOP.
Oh, Paul Ellering.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Paul Ellering. Because he turns on the Road Warriors.
Yeah, we get Precious Paul Ellering coming up soon. And then our final match for the month of February, we get
an ugly squash.
Men mm-hmm. on a Mission against Brooklyn Brawler. And did anybody get this other
Steve guy's Smith?
Name? Steve Smith. Okay.
Yeah.
I just
most generic white man name ever.
I just put Jobber McFuckboy because I couldn't hear the fucking name.
Yeah. No. Steve Smith and spell with a Y.
Smythe. Your name is Smythe, sir. But yeah, this
don't understand that shit.
This match was, to quote Terry Funk, bowling shoe ugly.
It was an ass whooping.
Yeah, this was bad. You could have opened the show with this one, and it would have been awesome. You could have saved Randy and Yoko for your fucking main event, because that's a main event angle, because that's your world champion. And you fucking make him the curtain jerker. Fuck out of here.
I blame Kevin Dunn for this. I don't even know if Kevin Dunn had anything to do with it, but I blame Kevin Dunn.
It's your fault. It's your fault, Kevin. But yeah, this was simply put just a Men on a Mission squash match because they are going to be facing the Quebecers at Mania for the World Tag Team Championship.
Yeah.
Random choice. I mean, Men on a Mission was over, for sure. But it's so random.
You want to know something? Outside of the main events, I mean, I don't remember this card at all.
Yeah, I don't either.
Like, none of these matches sound like they happened. It all seems like a fever dream when I ran down that WrestleMania card.
The only other one that I remember is Crush and Randy. I remember that one. I remember that one because of the ending of the match.
Yeah, the ending of the match is great. But yeah, those three matches, the only three matches that I remember.
Yeah, all the other ones, I'm like, sure, that happened.
Yeah. So I can't wait till we watch WrestleMania 10 because I can't.
Dude, so it's like Bret and Owen, the ladder match, crushing Randy, and then Bret and Yoko.
Yeah, there's only four matches I remember.
Yeah, because other than that, I got nothing. Yeah. I got a whole lot of nothing.
Yeah.
So. You could have told me Goldberg and Rob Van Dam wrestled on this fucking show, and I'd have been like, sure.
Yeah, okay.
Sure, it happened.
And speaking of WrestleMania 10, for anybody watching, we're going to be doing a live watch-along.
Oh, we are? Are we still doing that?
Hell yeah. We are.
Good. Yes.
Fuck yeah.
Yay.
Cool. Hell yeah. So, well, that'll be what? 2 weeks?
Yeah.
Yeah, because next week's March, and then...
Yeah, because we got the first...
Oh, yeah, because it's in March.
Yeah, because we got the first two or three... Raws before Mania. Yeah.
Well, I think it's two.
Yeah. Yeah, because it's like middle of the month.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. So
WrestleMania is in March in 94?
Yeah.
March 20th.
Okay. I'm just so used to it being in April.
Yeah, I'm used to it starting April now.
Mm-hmm.
So, but yeah, that's going to be fun. Yeah. The live watch along.
Oh, yeah. She's going to love those matches.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. That the Bret and Owen match, you're going to be like, fuck yes, the entire time.
Yeah. She's going to fucking freak out about that ladder match, too.
Oh, yeah.
Sean Razor go off.
Aww. Yeah,
the ladder match that started it all. Like,
technically not even, but that's WWF just wants to put you there.
Right. I should say in the WWE landscape, that's the one that like starts it all for ladder matches in that company.
Even though Canada was doing ladder matches for like 10 years beforehand.
Right, right. Yeah, other companies around the world were doing fucking ladder matches.
Like literally the Hearts were doing ladder matches in Stampede in like the mid-80s.
If it ain't in the WWE, it don't count.
Yeah. Fucking Vince and Kevin Dunn, you lying bastards.
Yeah, well, luckily we don't have to deal with Kevin Dunn anymore. Yay!
Yay! Alright. Yeah. So, that wraps it up for February of 1994 on the road to WrestleMania. So, again, very soon we're going to be talking about March and then WrestleMania itself. But, if you liked what you watched, like the video, subscribe to the World Championship Records YouTube channel, check out all the other shit that's coming out on the page. There's new stuff coming.
Yeah, he's coming. We finally have shit coming out.
There are some things coming.
Yeah, somebody big is coming.
He is coming.
I wish we had video like he is coming.
We'll work on that. We'll get something together for it.
And also comment, you know, all that other shit. So. From the Tribal Quuen Breigh, Mighty Pluses, Husky Rhodes. Thank you guys for watching Queen's Court, and we will see you next time.
If you're still alive.